fellow with the Schumacher Institute for Sustainable Systems, the author of Nanotechnology and Global Equality. He co-founded the Post-Growth Institute, which explores economic paths that don't rely on growth, and founded Project Australia, which helps people start and sustain non-profit or not-for-profit initiatives. So, being in the business of localizing and initiating, it makes him a kind of a pin-up bloke for this confab. Over to you, Donnie.
There are so many amazing things happening around Australia. In fact, for the last 4.5 billion years, there have been so many amazing things happening on this land. And I suspect that for the next 4.5 billion years, there'll continue to be amazing things happening on this land. And the fact that each of us is made up of 7 billion atoms and a consciousness that is universal suggests to me we've been around for all of that, and we'll be around for all of it to come. One of the most amazing things that's happening in Australia is that there are over 700,000 not-for-profit organisations in this country. That means that for every 30 people in this audience, there's a not-for-profit, an organisation that's set up with its primary purpose to fulfil social needs. One of the most amazing not-for-profits I've discovered in the last few years is called OzHarvest. They work in the space of taking meals that would otherwise be discarded and returning those back into community to people in need as meals. And I just learned recently that they've passed 16 million meals that have been delivered to people since their origination. This is in a country of 21 million people. The Youth Food Movement, a group of really energetic people that came together, particularly out of Sydney, run wonderful events like Passata Day, drawn from Italian heritage, where when the crops are ripe in terms of tomatoes, which happens so often, they pull in the tomatoes and they have a day of fun bottling. They put the tomatoes, stuff them in to the containers and jars, and they celebrate and they deliver the jars of tomato pulp and puree to people around. And they run programs like Ride On Lunch, where they will get bicycles and swing past neighborhoods, and as people see them, they will invite other people to join them on the bicycles and take extra bicycles with them and all cycle along to a locally prepared lunch somewhere. Wonderful enthusiasm and beauty. In 1900 venues around Australia, every single week, alcoholics meet anonymously and share and work through processes together locally. Last year on May 5th, 8,640 people held events where they put out their items that weren't wanted anymore in the garage sales as part of Garage Sale Trail. Unbelievable amount of events where people said, let's reuse, let's recycle through our local networks materials that are unwanted to me that might be wanted to you. So many amazing things are going on all around this country. Just in the last year, we learned that 1 million photovoltaic in 1 million households in Australia, there are now photovoltaic units on the tops of roofs. That's around 10% of the Australian population have PV units on their roofs. That's an incredible thing that just crept up on us so magically. And it's really changing the dynamics in terms of the energy balance and grid parity and these sorts of issues. Everywhere I look, I see wonderful things happening. And I'm inspired by these things every single day. And I think Australia is a really great place to actually engage and drive and develop the localization movement, in particular for one little reason that often gets forgotten. So yes, we had the Sydney Olympics here, and for any of you who, anyone in the audience who was around for the Sydney Olympics, you remember it, huh? It was amazing in terms of the attitude, the vibrancy, so similar to this conference, in fact, in terms of that heart space people came from. And the multiculturalism that's in this country that really got brought out beautifully in those Olympics in many ways. So we have things like that, but I also think we have something very special too, in the sense that every New Year's Day, in terms of Western New Year's Day, we're the first major Western country that's considered to be the first to wake up. We're actually at the start of the news cycle. And strategically, that's really valuable in terms of what emerges, to be able to start a new day in the Western world and to put things out into a new cycle and say, we're turning over a leaf, we're building on this, we're developing this. And in my work with about 200 community organizations so far, there's four things I wanted to share with you today that are lessons from what I've seen and things that are really working well at the moment. The first is, and it's a paradox. The first is that the best ideas that I see emerging in the localization space and the best ideas that I've seen that have had success are the simplest ideas. But they are also the hardest ideas. They are the ones that take the most blood, sweat, and tears. In my own small town on Guringai land, 1 hour north of Sydney, on a river, in an island, we spent 2 years developing a directory of people's passions, knowledge, skills, resources they wanted to share. This is a conservative small town that I'm from, that if I had approached it in any other way and said, hey, let's talk about sharing economy, or hey, who wants to lend something to their neighbor, I know from history, perhaps wouldn't have worked so well. But we spent 2 years of going through a process with a very simple idea, which was to liberate all sorts of things that people didn't know about. It took 2 years, but then we had 550 things in our small little town of 1,000 people, 550 things that people put into a book, just saying how available you wanted to make the thing you were offering and whether or not you wanted to charge for it, and then it had your contact details in the back. Simple idea, probably about 1,500 hours worth of effort to go into it, an incredible amount of work to keep something offline rather than online. So simple, yet hardest. The second learning I've had is what I call the asset-based approach. From the research that I've done and the experiences that I've had, including at this event, when we start with what's working, we actually open up the receptivity of those with whom we engage. Right now, if I start these presentations I did with what's working, I build trust with my audience. I'm not here to put you in a space where you need to judge me necessarily. I build that receptivity by starting with what's working and what we can commonly agree on. And then, if we want, we can move into the space with that trust having been built to actually explore things on a deeper level. And that creativity then emerges so much more strongly, I found, in community projects and relocalization initiatives when you start with what's working. And not just in community development, but in the talks you give, the presentations you give, the articles you write. It moves away from the deficit model that is so pervasive in our media, in our conferences, in our academia, all sorts of spaces. Start with what's working and you change the game in terms of the way to connect. The third thing is the power of the web is actually leveling the playing field, even though it's an uneven playing field from the beginning. But incredible potential is actually there in terms of the power of the web. There's a lot of talk in the localization space of, you know, moving away from globalization. Yet, of course, we know with any forms of movement, an asset-based approach starts by looking at what's amazing in this space. And the fact is that the web is doing something that I would say for the first time in the last 30 years opens up the potential for relocalization to actually work as an economics of happiness. And it does so in particular through geocoding, through the ability to map on maps where things are, to allocate and to identify resources much more efficiently. This is one of the biggest strengths. Think about meetup.com, or think about any kind of mashup that you've seen of data and Google Maps and what it can do in terms of actually connecting in and strengthening a localization movement. And this is not even adding into all the amazing things that happened that probably brought half the audience or more here through the power of that wouldn't have been the case otherwise. And the fourth thing is I'm seeing an incredible uptake and new understanding about the power of not-for-profit economy, not-for-profit enterprises. Most people don't understand that not-for-profits can make as much profit as they want. They just have to redistribute it according to their objects in their constitution. The world's biggest not-for-profit, it's BRAC, Bangladeshi not-for-profit with 100,000 employees, works to support 10 million people worldwide in health and education and other areas. 80% of the world's biggest not-for-profit, 80% of its revenue, where does it come from? It comes from its own enterprises, craft stores, bakeries, printing press. It's not philanthropically dependent, it's not government dependent, it's not dependent on any big corporation. This stuff is changing the game. When people understand they can run successful businesses under a not-for-profit framework. Right now I'm working with a team at the Post-Growth Institute to actually design an alternative macroeconomic framework using an asset-based approach grounded in not-for-profit enterprise. I have no background in economics whatsoever. But I did a PhD looking at nanotechnology, and I had absolutely no background in nanotechnology either. I started with the strengths and I built on things, and there were the words of one man that echoed in my head throughout that process in nanotechnology that echo as I take on the biggest challenge of my life to design an alternative economic system that works, that's incentivized and inclusive of the 1% as much as the 99%. And I want to share these words and end with these words today and introduce it by telling you a little bit about this man first. His name was Shed Townes. He was a footballer up until the age of 30, and then he had a life-changing experience. I met him when he was about 45. He came to give a talk at the school I was attending. He told us of his life story. He told us of these events that happened and how he really, after a point in his 30s, started to live his real dreams, which was in a whole lot of other sports and achievement and doing things that mattered to him. He practiced cycling for a triathlon. He was trying to do the Hawaiian Ironman. That was one of his dreams. He practiced cycling and he fell off a cliff in the Blue Mountains. And so what did he do? He put some bells on the back and had someone ride behind him because he was worried about his balance and all sorts of things. He got into one of the triathlons, and it was an out-at-sea marker where the turning point was in halfway along the course in the swim leg. He turned the wrong way. He got lost out at sea for a few hours. The next triathlon, he strapped his leg to another man's leg in the swim section so as not to get disoriented and lost. He did the Hawaiian Ironman. He jumped out of a plane, which was a long dream, and he died climbing Mount Everest. The thing that had happened back in his 30s before all of this was he'd become blind. And he said to me the words that I want to pass on to you today that tie in with all of our localization initiatives. He said, "Donnie, you don't have to be a champion to do champion things. You don't have to be a champion to do champion things."